real life.
Welcome to iFocus lecture 161, retina module number 13. Today we are starting with retinal electrophysiology. Today we have part one, and on Friday we'll have part two. We have four speakers today, and the program has been designed by Dr. Subhadra Jalali. We have Dr. Brijesh Thakkar, Dr. Deepika CP, Virendra Sachdeva, and Dr. Subhadra Jalali herself, all from LV Prasad Eye Institute for today. And for the next module on Friday, Dr. Parveen Sen will be speaking, but fortunately she has joined today as well, and she'll contribute to discussion. Next slide, please. Yeah, it's very difficult to introduce Subhadra Jalali in a couple of minutes, extremely difficult. I would just say that she is the kind of leader in ROP. She has established ROP as a standalone subspecialty as part of retina. She has trained a huge number of retina specialists in screening and managing ROP. That is her high point, saving a lot of children's eyes and vision. And of course, she has special interest in electrophysiology. Next slide. Brijesh Thakkar is from AIIMS RP Center, and he did his senior residency in AIIMS, followed by a short stint in DMC Ludhiana and AIIMS Bhopal, and currently he is the consultant in Vitreoretina at LV Prasad Eye Institute. Next slide. Deepika is from Karnataka, and she did a post-graduation from Prabha Eye Clinic and Research Center, fellowship in LVPI, and currently a faculty at LV Prasad Eye Institute. She has special interest in, I believe, pigmentary retinopathy and also electrophysiology. Next slide. Virendra Sachdeva is actually not from Vitreoretina Services as a slide. He's from pediatric ophthalmology, strabismus, and neuro-ophthalmology. He's from MAMC, New Delhi, MS from Safdarjung Hospital, University of Delhi, fellowship in pediatric ophthalmology from LVPI, and currently a faculty at GMR campus of LVPI in Vishakhapatnam. So I hand you over to Dr. Jalali for a very brief introduction about the course, and then we can start off.
Hi, friends. Thank you for being with us tonight. So basically, we thought that, you know, I am not an expert in everything. So we've got the best experts in various parts of the ERG and VEP. So the visual electrophysiology basically is going to be talked about by all of us turn by turn. And we've kept ample time for the question answers. I know that for most of you, this is not sort of mainstream PG work. It's not sort of exam related, because you may not get an ERG to read, just like the MD medicine people definitely get an ECG to read. But that day is still very far away. It will come one day when the retinal treatments for retinal dystrophies will start, then it will be part of curriculum.
But I think ERG, they do have ERG.
No, I said it may not come as your case.
Yes.
And because many of the people who are examining you, the cases, they may not be very clear about the ERGVP. So they won't give it to you as a case. Rarely it may come as a part of your theory question. But I think at least a basic all of you should know. Reason for that is that sometimes the patient will come with a report and you're an ophthalmologist. At least you should be able to say that this is an ERG or this is a VP, and start having some interest. I have interest in electrophysiology basically because I know that one day I will stop doing surgeries when I get arthritis or Parkinson's or something. And that time I'm going to still be the best electrophysiologist, and people will come to me with all their queries and questions on these things. And only my mind, I know, will never go down till that time. So when I stop doing surgeries, I will still be doing electrophysiology. So over to you, Brijesh. He's going to speak first. Go ahead.
Thank you, madam.
Or is there going to be some introduction before that? No, we've done. No. Okay.
Hopefully my slides are visible.
Yeah. Go to slides.
So good evening all. So this is how I have divided my talk into. So I'm basically trying to cover full field flash ERG over here. And we'll try to go step by step, and also stick to the ICEF, that is protocols which are standardized, so that it is helpful for the PGs present. So introduction, I think Dr. Jalali, Dr. Hunawar both have given. So we are basically talking about visual electrophysiology, which means that we are eliciting some response from the retina, and we are looking at what kind of response that is, and somehow we will tailor it to the disorder which is present and also try to prognosticate it. So these are the types of ERG. So I shall be restricting myself to full field and flash ERGs. So what's the physiology? So as we already know that whenever the light will hit the retina, the Wald cycle will kick in inside the RP and photoreceptors. You will have the breakdown of the pigments. And as a result of that, the first thing which happens electrically is the hyperpolarization of the photoreceptors. And this is followed by a transmission of signal to the bipolar cells and consequently to the ganglion cells. And then via the optic nerve, it will reach the brain also. While all this is happening, certain waveforms are being generated inside the retina. So after the studies which led to Nobel Prize in the last century, we found that there are a couple of waves which are generated, the A wave, the B wave, the C wave, and the D wave. So the A wave basically represents the signals which are being generated from the photoreceptors, the inner or the outer segments. The B waves are coming from the second order neurons, which are the bipolar cells, whereas the C wave is kicking in from the RPE cells. Now, all this, I'm sure most of us have already read or some of us have also seen. So somewhere it starts creating confusion in our mind. But to bring it down to the basic level, I will say that just think of the fact that first hyperpolarization occurs at the level of the photoreceptors. So the first wave has to be the A wave, which comes from the photoreceptors. The second order neuron is the bipolar cells. So the second wave which comes is the B wave from the bipolar cells. The first was a hyperpolarization wave, so it's a negative wave. The second is a depolarization wave, so it's a positive wave. So if we think like this, it becomes a bit easy for us to understand and also correlate to our patients. So the technical aspect also we need to know, because this is a very sensitive test and it is affected by the environment to which our patient is predisposed to. So there are a couple of things we need to know about: the electrodes, the light source, and the signal amplifiers which are used. So the electrodes can be either corneal contact lens electrodes or what is called as non-contact electrodes. They do have contact, but they don't have contact lenses. So these are basically either foil based or loop based electrodes which are placed inside the fornix. So the second set of electrodes, these electrodes are the positive electrodes. The second set of electrodes that we use are the reference electrodes, which go into the negative input of the ERG machine to complete the circuit. And these are typically placed on the temporal margin of the orbit. And we need to take care not to place them over the muscles so that the EMG does not interfere with the ERG. The third electrode is obviously the ground electrode. So it can be placed either on the forehead or earlobe or elsewhere also. So these are some photographs of these electrodes. So this is how a loop electrode looks like. This is how a contact lens electrode looks like, which is also known as the Purian Allen electrode. And these are some of the other electrodes that we commonly use. So the second aspect over here is the light source. So the light source is very important because we need to maintain a equivalent and diffuse light present throughout the visual field of the eye. And we rely mostly on the Ganzfeld stimulator, which looks somewhat like this. And this is used to provide a fixed illuminance to the eye throughout the test. Now, this illuminance has been standardized by the International Society for Clinical Electrophysiology and Vision, also known as ISEV. So this illumination has to be kept constant and it has to be monitored throughout the days and the months to maintain the illuminance, to be sure that the perfect illuminance is present. So once all this is being done, the electrode is on the patient and he is looking into the Ganzfeld system and he's been made to sit down comfortably, we start generating some waveforms. So what are these waveforms? I mentioned them briefly before. Now I'll go into the details of them. So the first negative wave is the A wave, and this is how it will look like. This is how the A waves look like. So usually the A waves which are generated by the rod cells, they will have a broader base, whereas the ones generated by the cone cells seen in the photopic ERG, they will have a sharper edge. Similarly, the B wave is the second positive wave which arises like this. Again, the one generated by the rod cells in combination with the cone cells has a broader peak, whereas the one generated only by the cone cells in the photopic responses has a sharper peak. So I will suggest that while there is a lot of talk about amplitudes and implicit times of ERG, this is something that we need to remember and to look carefully in those printouts to assess multiple things. So what are these things we'll discuss later, but we do need to have this normative picture in our heads to actually dissect the ERG and to know what is happening. So the other way which is commonly used is the oscillatory potentials. So this is how the oscillatory potentials look like. They are being generated by the amacrine cells. And as I've shown before, the amacrine cells are horizontal cells. So these waves are not the dominant waves because they're not in line with the axis of the electrodes and the retina. However, usually they will be seen as three waves first, followed by fourth diminishing waves. We don't have very clear-cut standards how to measure them, but typically they are measured in terms of their amplitude itself and their presence. Their presence means that their presence or their absence. So even the ICEF says that there is no clear-cut way of measuring or denoting them. So the C wave is usually not taken into account, but just as a theoretical discussion, it arises from the RP cells due to the change in anion levels and cation levels in the subretinal space. And the D wave is the last wave, which is generated by the off bipolar cells. It will be seen when ERG has been done for a long time and the electrical stimulus has been given for a long time. So it's a positive wave again. It comes very late in the ERG flow. So the other aspect is the flicker response. The flicker response is considered very sensitive for the cone pathways, and this is how it will look like. And the measurement is done from the point of the flash or the previous stimulus half down till the peak of the next rise in the flicker. So this presence of this wave basically tells us whether the cone cells are functioning well or not. So this is in brief a recap of all this, and I think this is absolutely essential for the PGs to know. And as Dr. Jalali was mentioning, although you may not get a long case, but you will be asked questions about them in the investigative modalities. So now going deeper, so we need to have maximal pupillary dilation before performing flash ERGs. The electrodes have to be placed carefully, as I discussed before. The dark adaptation has to be given for 20 minutes. Now, this is an ICEF standard, and ideally, it should not be broken. If it is broken, it must be mentioned in the reporting. For the light adaptation, we must do the adaptation for 10 minutes before we start the light testing. So the measurements are very easy to understand. So the A wave, the amplitude is from its baseline to the trough. And while for the B wave, it is from the trough of the A wave till the peak of the B wave. The implicit time, it is from the time of start of the flash till the time of A wave trough. And for the B wave, the implicit time is from the start time of the flash to the peak of the B wave. So there are various nomenclatures that we use. So these nomenclatures, these are again have been told by the ICEF itself. So these are the basic waveforms which we report while we are dealing with ERG. Is scotopic 0.01, scotopic 3.0, scotopic 10 ERG. So these are all the scotopic ERGs that we do up along with the scotopic oscillatory potentials. So this 0.01, 3.0 and 10, they basically reflect the intensity of stimulus which is being used. So 3.0 will mean a 3 candela per square meter stimulus. And these two are done in the light adapted state. Yeah, so there again, these are the numerical values which the ICEF has actually provided us to follow as a standard by performing and reporting the ERGs. So these you will easily find in the books. So the dark adapted state, the first response that is being tested is the 0.01 response. And this is basically telling us about a very broad idea about the rod system. This usually you will not find an A wave in the dark adapted state, and this is how it will look like. So this just generally it will tell us that the rod cells are functioning well in the scotopic state. So this is the scotopic 3.0 ERG. So here you'll get a good A wave, a good B wave, and this is basically a combined response coming from both cones and rod cells seen in the scotopic state. So this is a dark adapted 10.0 ERG. Here the flash stimulus is very strong, And here, this is basically used to see the A wave. The A wave is very clearly seen while using this kind of test. And again, I'm just going back a slide. If this 3.0 ERG is not being well get, we can always perform a 10.0 ERG to have a better waveform. So as I mentioned before, oscillative potentials have been used a bit, but we don't have very standardized values and or standardized fashion of measuring them. So usually they are just measured as present or absent. And in some cases, people do check their amplitudes as well. So these are basically oscillative potentials are basically used to look at ischemia of the middle retina, like in cases of ocular ischemic syndrome. So this is the light adapted 3.0 ERG as a single flash. So it is being used to check the function of the cone driven pathway in light adapted state. And it again has very sharp A waves and very sharp B waves. And this is how a flicker response looks like. So presence of this response tells us that the cone system is working well. So there are some other extended protocols also, but these are not very standardized. And even the ISAV, although mentions them, it encourages the labs to do it their own way. I will not be going into them today. So basically for the PG level, I think we need to distinguish between the photopic and scotopic ERGs. So we should understand that the photopic ERG will have lower amplitudes. Scotopic ERG will get higher amplitudes because we have more cells which are responding. However, the scotopic ERG also has a longer implicit time. So while we have been talking about normal ERG and I'm running short on time, I'll just show you some abnormal cases also. I think they'll be discussed more in the second part of the discussion. So this is how a normal ERG would look like. This is how a supranormal ERG would look like. And this is how a subnormal ERG would look like. So we should have this picture in our head while we are looking at ERGs as students or even as doctors, qualified doctors later on. So supranormal response is rare, but it is seen in early siderosis in albinism and certain other systemic diseases. Subnormal response is what we see more commonly as ophthalmologist, and we'll encounter it in cases like early retinitis pigmentosa, some drug toxicity, and some vitamin deficiencies. So there's a concept of negative ERG that we must understand. So this means that only negative waveforms is present, which means that the B positive wave is absent. So there are certain diseases like congenital stationary night blindness, RP, CRO, CRVO, and certain other diseases in which we know that the B wave to A ratio has gone less than one, and this is characteristic negative ERG. So then you have the case of extinguished ERG, which is seen in diseases which are very strong or very bad, or they have reached advanced level. So typical example is an advanced RP or a long-standing retinal detachment or Leber's congenital amaurosis or CRO. So this is how the ERG looks like in these cases. So in cases with retinal vein occlusions, this I was mentioning a bit before also. So ERG can help us in distinguishing between the lesser ischemic forms from the severely ischemic forms, like in a case of CRVO. And we do have certain metrics to differentiate on the basis of the ERG itself. So this is an example of a case of, I think, a child less than 6 years, a girl child, and she came with night blindness. And if you look at the ERGs, so this is flash 0.01, background 0.0. This means scotopic ERG using this intensity of flash. And NM over here means non-measurable. So this was a case of non-measurable ERGs in the scotopic mode, whereas the photopic mode was normal. So on the basis of clinical presentation and the ERG, we could label the case as fundus albipunctus. Now, this is a case of macular dystrophy. What you will find over here is that in the scotopic background, the ERG has waveforms and is grossly near normal, whereas the photopic ERG is like a flat line with non-measurable response. So this is a case of cone dystrophy. So this is a case in which both photopic and scotopic are literally non-measurable or in very low values. This is a case of advanced atypical retinitis pigmentosa. So then there are other diseases like ocular siderosis, which will go in certain stages. I was alluding to this before also. Earlier, you will have supranormal response, then you will have a negative ERG, and finally, you will have a flat ERG. So certain times, the ERG will not be same for one disease. It can depend on the stage in which you are seeing the patient. So just to summarize, so I think FFERG is a measure of change in resting potential for the eye after being stimulated by a flash. So we should measure this only in fully dilated pupil and in a very electrically stable environment. The ERG is contributed mainly by radially arranged cells of the retina. That means the cone, the rod cells, driven pathways. And the standard waveform, we must remember the A waves, the B waves, the OPs. The C waves and D waves are rarely encountered and rarely used. The various causes exist for abnormal ERG waveforms. I think the part two of this particular forum will discuss more about that. So thank you all. Thank you, Team CFS and iFocus.
Thank you, Brijesh. So are there any questions for Dr. Brijesh?
Not yet, ma'am.
Okay. So still digesting.
Ma'am, we'll get the questions all together at the end of the session.
Okay. I thought Brijesh can then relax. Okay, Brijesh, you have to be on your toes till the end of the session. Okay.
I'm going to join in if he has any inputs at this point in time. If you want to ask something. Dr. Dilesh?
You are muted, Dilesh.
You said about retinal detachment having a non-recordable response. But I think there is also, I think you would try a bright flash ERG and you would get a response in that, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Any comments on that?
True, Dr. Dinesh. So if we have extinguished ERG, we can always try the 10.0 ERG to elicit a response. But I was referring to a chronic old RD when I was...
Yeah, I think it's important because, you know, very often people use the ERG to tell whether a patient should be prognosticating for surgery, which is not an acceptable thing. The normal ERG has no value in prognosticating for a detachment, you know. So I think that's one point clinically significant which you need to stress for them, that you don't use the, you use the ERG for lots of things, but you don't use it to diagnose or you do not use it to prognosticate a detachment or to decide whether you want to operate on it or not.
Yes, that is correct. So as we go in the course, we will see that the flash ERG has nothing to do with the visual acuity. It's only telling us the health of the retina overall, but it doesn't have any bearing on the visual acuity because it's a generalized response. Okay, we can go to the next talk. Deepika, you will share.
Are my slides visible in full screen?
Yes, Deepika.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Hello, everyone. A very good evening. Thank you, team iFocus, Dr. Honaur and Dr. Jalali, to be for making me part of this program. It's always nostalgic to be in iFocus. Few years back, I was attending as a resident, and it's a wonderful opportunity to present here on a few topics. I'll be speaking on electrooculogram. So in this talk, what we will be learning is the definition of EOG, requirements and procedure of EOG, the components of EOG, how to interpret an electrooculogram, and also it will be followed by case-based examples. Before going into the term EOG, one should understand what is meant by standing potential of the eye. Any cell will have its own standing potential. Similarly, the standing potential of the eye is referred to difference in electrical potential between the anterior and posterior part of the eye. So one can assess the change in standing potential. So how can we do that? So we can change the illumination to the eye, thereby changing the retinal cells adaptation, in turn resulting in change in the standing potential. So that's how it is measured. So the standing potential of the eye majorly refers to the transepithelial potential of the retinal pigment epithelium. Hence, EOG is termed as an electrophysiological test of the outer retina and retinal pigment epithelium. So it records the electrical potential across the RPE, and also it will be influenced by the photoreceptor function. how do we record it? We record it during successive periods of dark and light adaptation of the retinal cells. That is, in this period, we are changing the adaptation of the cells, in turn influencing the standard potential and measuring the potential over there. So the EOG requires certain materials to be there. It requires dilated pupils, that is must. The maximum recommended dilatation of the pupil is 7 mm by ICEF. We require electrodes. The standard silver chloride or gold cup electrodes are required. Skin surface should be clean before we place the electrodes to avoid the impedance. Ganswell dome, which was described in the full field ERG talk also, it is a recommended machine. So in the Ganswell dome, as we saw in previous talk also, it will produce a standard illuminance, which will be diffuse. The recommended for EOG as per recent 2017 update by the ICEF is 100 candelas per meter square. It is a dome with uniform intensity of the light. The dome will also have two fixation points on either side of the two eyes. It's about 15 degrees from the right and left center of the eyes. So in the EOG procedure recording, what one will do is we place the electrodes on outer and as well as inner canthus of the eye, followed by a ground electrode on the forehead. All these electrodes will be connected to the amplifier to get the measurements in microvolts. The components of recording of the EOG includes recording of the cycles, recording of EOG in dark phase, recording of EOG in light phase. So what are these cycles? These cycles are induced by alternatively illuminated light, where the patient's eye will be moving alternatively to the right, to the left, seeing the red target, which will be there in the Ganswell bulb. So the seconds are recorded for first 10 seconds of each minute, and each seconds will be there for 1 second. So it's a quick movement, which will be measured in the first 10 seconds of each minute. So the dark phase will be there for 15 minutes, followed by a light phase of 15 minutes. These are the components of EOG. It will have two components, as we described in the previous slides also. So this is the first phase where the lights will be off, which is called as dark phase. It is light insensitive and it depends on the retinal pigment epithelial integration. It accounts for the dark trough. So what is dark trough? So if we see over here in the dark phase, the amplitudes are getting reduced. So the minimum amplitude in the dark phase is called as dark trough. So the next phase is lights on phase, which is called the light phase. This is a light sensitive phase. It depends on depolarization of basal membrane of the RP. So depolarization, hence the amplitude should be increasing. So the light phase is starting from here. We see that the amplitudes are increasing. The maximum amplitude recorded in the light phase is called as light peak. So these are the two important terminologies which we have to know in EOG, the dark trough and the light peak. So in any ERG recording, these are very important. The dark trough in the normal patients will come around 8 to 12 minutes. The light peak will be 6 to 9 minutes from the beginning of the light phase. Arden ratio is the ratio of the light peak to dark trough. Let's move to interpretation of EOG. As for any interpretation of any investigation, the demographic features, age and gender and clinical photographs should be correlated. The pupil size should be measured and recorded. The third point is looking for cycles. Also look for pattern of individual waveform. Then identify the dark trough and light peak along with amplitudes of that. The final step will be to calculate the Arden ratio. So let's move ahead and see how an EOG of normal patient will look. So in the left-hand side, we have this. So these are called the cycles. The cycles, all these should be checked out to rule out any missing eye movements or artifacts. In these cases, we will see that either the waveform is missed or it will be a huge elevation. Okay, in these cases, that means the cycles are not good and the report which we are going to get subsequently in the EOG is also not reliable. So this cycle should be in a good pattern, which is referred to as sine waveform. So if the cycles are good and the final EOG reporting will be reliable. So let us see the Arden ratio, dark trough and light peak. So in this, we see that this is the dark phase, the first 10 to 12 minutes, followed by the light phase in the next 10 to 12 minutes. So what we have to do, we have to first identify the dark turf. So as dark turf is the minimum amplitude in the dark phase, so this is the first red arrow which is there is the dark turf. It is followed by onset of the light phase. So the light peak will be the maximum amplitude in the light phase. So it is very simple. Identify the dark turf followed by light peak. Then we should also check for the timing of the dark trough and the light peak. So the timing over here is it is coming around 8 minutes. And once if we see the light peak, it is also coming around 7 to 8 minutes. So we are in the normal range of the onset of dark trough and light peak in this patient because this is normal. The next one is Arden ratio, which is the light peak divided by dark trough ratio. In turn, the minimum versus maximum versus minimum amplitude. Sorry. So what is normal Arden ratio? The values are as below. The normal is 1.80 or greater Arden ratio. Subnormal is referred to 1.65 to 1.80. When the Arden ratio is less than 1.65, it is called significantly subnormal. In other way, in alternative form, they can be expressed in percentages also as seen in this report. In the right eye, it is said it is reported as 211%. In the left eye, it is reported as 195%. So we have learned how a normal ERG looks. Let us solve one or two cases for the better understanding of the procedure. It is a 22-year-old male with the right eye vision of 20/60, left eye 20/40, family history of similar complaint in the sibling as well. We see that in both eyes, the macula is affected. We can see subretinal yellow deposit material, some amount of subretinal scarring as well with pigmentary changes, atrophy, and also a hypopigmented mark of a circular region in both eyes. So let's see how an EOG of this patient will look at this stage. So we will go step by step as I highlighted in the interpretation of EOG. So the saccades over here are good. We do not have any artifacts or missing waveforms. And the waveforms here in sine wave. Coming to the report, we see that the line which is over here is very straight. There is no minimum dip. There is no maximum peak. So that indicates that there is no dark trough and there is no light peak as well. Arden ratio is coming to 99% in both the eyes, which is again less than 165. It is significantly abnormal. Thereby, EOG in this case confirms the diagnosis of best vitelliform macular dystrophy. Let us solve one more case. Here is a fundus picture of both eyes where we can see the yellow arrows which are pointed is showing subretinal yellow deposits around the fovea. We can also see that there are subretinal yellow deposits along the arcades, and this is a diffuse distribution of the subretinal yellow deposits. The fundus autofluorescence image over here is very beautiful, which is showing hyper autofluorescence subretinal dots here and also along the arcades with near to the optic disc as well. If we see closely, there are some hyper autofluorescence changes in the background fundus as well. Optical coherence tomography in both eyes, it's showing intraretinal fluid, subretinal hyperreflective deposits, few elongated photoreceptors, and a very huge subretinal fluid, which is again showing a diffuse distribution of the disease. Let's see, in this case, both ERG and EOG are significant to interpret and to come to a conclusion. Let us see how an ERG will look first, followed by EOG. So we had discussion of full field ERG just a while ago. This is a full field ERG, but grossly we can appreciate that in both eyes, the cone-mediated photopeak responses, as well as the rod-mediated dark adapter responses, there's slight decrease in the amplitudes in both eyes. So we can say that the ERG is also affected in a subnormal way over here. EOG, let us interpret in the same points as I told before. The saccades are good. We see that all are in the same line. Sine wave pattern is there. Again, the line over here is very straight. We do not have any dark trough or light peak. Arden ratio here, it is indicated as 1.3 for the right eye and the left eye is 1.2. Again, less than 1.65, so it is significantly abnormal. So this makes the diagnosis of autosomal recessive bestrophopathy very clear cut. where we will have both the ERG and EOG affected. Whereas in the best vitelliform macular dystrophy, which was the previous case, the ERG will be normal and EOG is affected. So what we learned so far is electrooculogram measures the potential that exists between cornea and back of the eye. Basically, it is a measure of photoreceptor and retinal pigment epithelium. So while interpreting an EOG, look at all the saccades to rule out missing eye movements or artifacts. The pattern of individual waveform should be sine wave. Arden ratio is the ratio of light peak to dark trough. Normal is 1.80 or greater, subnormal 1.65 to 1.80, and significantly subnormal is 1.65. So where do we use this EOG and where the light peak versus dark trough ratio is affected? So as per the mechanism, as we understood how the EOG standing potential is coming, wherever there is diffuse affection of the retinal pigment epithelium and also the photoreceptors, the EOG will be affected. Few of the diseases where it is characteristic and makes the diagnosis very clear are two diseases, best vitelliform spectrum of bests majorly. So the best vitelliform macular dystrophy, where the full field ERG will be normal and EOG is abnormal. In case of autosomal recessive bestrophinopathy, full field ERG as well as EOG will be abnormal. Also, in few cases of toxic retinopathies, we can see abnormal EOG and ERG. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thoroughly enjoyed that talk. I'm sure many people would have enjoyed, at least I enjoyed. So any questions? You want to take it later or any questions?
Ma'am, there is one question. Which diseases are best detected by ERG and which diseases are best detected by EOG? That is the question.
Yeah, good question, Amara. So ERG, as for both of them, we should understand which cells are affected. So in full field ERG, what cells we are doing is, it is a generalized measurement of the rods and cones. So wherever there is diffuse affection of the rods and cones, ERG is a better guide. This can be affected not only in the retinal dystrophies, in any other vascular occlusions, as we were discussing, any pathology for that, ischemic conditions, anything. So it responds the full field of the retina. So ERG will be affected in all those conditions. Whereas EOG, it is mainly from the retinal pigment epithelium, along with the coordination between the photoreceptors. So most of the times, retinal pigment epithelium means the major diseases affected are best disease and spectrum. So best disease, bestrophinopathies are the major diseases where EOG is recommended. Toxic retinopathies, only few reports are there where it has been useful is in cases of anti-retroviral diseases, didanosine, they've been shown that EOG is also abnormal. Previously for the chloroquine toxicity also, reports have found that EOG was also abnormal, but now multifocal ERG has taken over and that is more diagnostic. Okay. I hope you understood. Anything to add, Dr. Jalali?
So one concept everybody has to understand is that the only cell in the eye which responds to light is the photoreceptor. Mm-hmm. So if the photoreceptors are damaged, we cannot study the other parts of the eye by this method of light-induced electrophysiology. There are alternate methods. We'll come to that sometime later. But what we are testing here, all these tests which we are telling is, we are putting light on the eye, the photoreceptor is responding, and then the response generated by photoreceptors is passing on to other cells. When it passes to the RPE, then we are studying the EOG by a different method of saccades. When it passes to the optic nerve from the photoreceptors, then we are studying the optic nerve function. When it passes to the macula, we are looking at the multifocal ERG or pattern ERG. Now, if the photoreceptors are already damaged, let's say in retinal detachment or retinitis pigmentosa, then we cannot use these tests to study the